are putting more pressure on the church, because when the Christian church began, when the Christ followers began, they were kind of viewed as this sect of Judaism. And if you remember, the Romans and the Jews kind of had this agreement that the Romans said, you can still worship your God as long as you do it in this framework. As long as you do it in the framework that the Romans allow, you can still worship your God. As long as you are paying your money to Rome, you can still worship your God. And the Romans are putting more and more pressure on the Jews and on the Christians. And things are beginning to come to this head, all right? The next area where pressure is mounting is from the Jews, all right? So Christianity was viewed as this sect of Judaism, but yet the Jews did not view them as part of their culture or their religion, because they have started following Jesus, who the Jewish people believed was just a prophet and not God. So there's pressure mounting from the Jews, all right? And in Acts 8, 1 through 3, we can read that there was there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea, Samaria, except for the apostles. So the apostles stayed there in Jerusalem. The church kind of began to scatter, and what happens when this church scatters? And so we can't talk about Acts without talking about Stephen. And devoted men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him, but Saul was ravaging the church and entered house after house and dragging the men and women and committed them to prison. So you remember who Saul is, right? Saul is Paul, who had an encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus and became kind of this super apostle. And now those who were scattered went about, what did they do? Preaching the word. So although they were persecuted in Jerusalem and all these tensions and pressures were coming at the church, they were scattered, and what happens? The church expands. The church grows. The people that were being persecuted left Jerusalem. They went to Samaria and all these places around, and they started preaching the word, preaching about who Jesus is, sharing the gospel with people. And that made the church grow. That made the church expand. So this persecution, yeah, it's a terrible thing, but sometimes this persecution is a good thing, because it forces us out of our comfort zone and it forces us to share Jesus with places that we never thought we could. There were mounting pressures from families, because families that grew up in Judaism, that is part of their culture. That is a deep part of their culture. And when someone in the family converted to Christianity, that was a big deal. If someone in the family converted to Christianity that was not the father, the head of the family, that was punishable by death. That was punishable by having them taken off, put into prison. But I'll tell you this, if it was the father, the head of the family that converted to Christianity, the entire family was saved. The entire family was able to become part of the body of believers. So not only was the Romans putting pressure on the church and the Jews putting pressure on the church, but people's own family was putting pressure on the church. And then we come to this person named Nero. I don't know if you've ever heard of Nero before, but he was the emperor between 54 and 68 AD. So he is the emperor at the time that Peter is writing all of this. Nero Nero was a special kind of persecution. Okay? Nero, he was, he had some mental issues, in my opinion. All right? So Nero is the one that was really after the Christians. He would use the Christians as entertainment. He would kill Christians in a heartbeat just for being there. Nero was a special kind of persecution. All right? And the charges that were against the Christians were they were a rebellious sect of Judaism. All right, because they believed in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and being God. They were antisocial. They were even charged as atheists by the Romans because they only believed in one God. They didn't believe in all the gods, so they were considered to be atheists. They were considered to be cannibals because they were eating and drinking the body and the blood of Christ. Okay, have you ever heard that before? So that's what communion is. The bread represents his body, and the juice represents his blood, because Jesus died for our sins, and he was sacrificed, and that blood that was shed was the covering of our sins. And they hear people saying they're eating the body and the blood of Jesus, and they don't find out what they're talking about. All right? Persecution. Besides being put to death, Christians were made to serve as objects of amusement. They were clad in hides of the beasts and torn to death by dogs. Others were crucified. Others set on fire to serve as illuminant at night when the daylight failed. So this is how Christians were viewed in Nero's time. All right? So he is, yeah. So Christians in this time, in the early church, would you agree that they are persecuted? This is what persecution is. This is what it looks like. So this is kind of the culture that Peter and the apostles and the Christians are living in when 1 Peter is written. All right? So who is he writing to? This letter is considered a circular letter. Have you ever heard that term before? A circular letter. It's not written to just one church, but it's written to a multitude of churches. All right? He is trying to get this word out to a multitude of people. All right? In 1 Peter 1:1, Peter, the apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who were elected exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, these are the churches that Peter is writing to. Notice it says the exiles of the dispersion. This is the people that were run out of Jerusalem. This is the group of Christians that have gone out, and what were they doing? They were preaching the word, right? They were sharing God's grace with everyone. So the author of 1 Peter is fairly obvious when you start reading the letter, right? Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Peter, this is... now, I want to talk about Peter just a little bit and kind of his personality, all right? So we've looked at Peter over the last 3 weeks or so, and we've seen this personality of he is on fire. He is... Sometimes he does things without thinking, and sometimes he puts his foot in his mouth. All right, so this is kind of the character of Peter. And in Acts 14:13, and Peter becomes this foundation of the church. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated common men, they were astonished, and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. So they viewed Peter as uneducated and a common man. Do you remember what Peter did before he started following Jesus? Oh, you got to talk louder. My ears are plugged.
He was a bookkeeper.
He was a fisherman. He probably did books with his business, but he was a fisherman, and he called, and Jesus called him, and they view fishermen as pretty common people. But Peter, I'll tell you this, Peter went to Capernaum and he studied and was educated in Capernaum. He was educated in the law. He was educated in the prophets. He was an educated man. So when people look at him and they hear his Galatian accent, they kind of suspect that he is uneducated. Have you ever heard an accent and just assumed, well, this guy's not very smart? Have you ever thought that? Now, that's racial profiling. I don't want you to do that anymore. Because they could be some of the most smart people you've ever met. But they hear Peter's Galatian accent, and they assume that he is uneducated. But he went to Capernaum, and he sat under rabbis, and he was taught, and he learned the law and the prophets and the entire Old Testament. He was an educated man. He knew that Jesus, he knew that the Messiah was coming. He didn't necessarily know it was Jesus before Jesus got there. But he knew the Messiah was coming, and they were expecting him, and they were looking for him. And when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they were astonished. Now, Peter in Scripture, he was a fisherman called to follow Jesus, present at Jesus' transfiguration. He walked on water. He makes the good confession, right? He says, Jesus, I believe you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. We talked about that last week. He denies Jesus three times. That's not the best part of his life, but it's an important part of his example to us. He runs to the empty tomb. He preaches the first sermon at Pentecost. He receives a vision of the Gentiles, and he is imprisoned for preaching. So these are kind of the highlights of Peter's life that we can take as an example in our life. He denied Jesus, but you know what? He was restored, and he became a foundation of the church. So the date of this writing, can we all agree that he had to write it before he died? All right, so Peter was put to death in 67 AD, all right? So he had to be before 67 AD. And then Peter was in prison, the same prison that Paul was in, but there is no contact. There is no writing or anything that says that overlapped. So this had to be written before 64 AD. So if you want to write this down, Peter, the first book, the first letter that Peter wrote, the first Peter, was written somewhere between 62 and 64 AD. All right? So in 65 is when the destruction of Jerusalem, 65. I can't even say the stupid word. Destruction of Jerusalem. So this is all happening just before Jerusalem is destroyed. Now, the purpose of Peter, of 1 Peter, it's a call to holiness and righteousness in troubled times. So when persecution strikes, what happens? We are called to be holy and righteous. We are called to work through this persecution in a certain way, all right? And that's what 1 Peter is going to explain to us, how to handle persecution when it strikes. It's not if it strikes, it's when it strikes, all right? So I have a challenge for you. 1 Peter is 5 chapters long. It doesn't take very long. My challenge for you this week, all right, this is, I think, on your card. My challenge for you this week is to sit down, take time, and read through 1 Peter. And what I want you to do is I want you to take a pencil, and I want you to underline every time it's talking about the word suffering. Suffer, suffering, suffered. I want you to underline that, all right? And this word, suffering, is suffering or mistreatment. That's one word that is used. And then here is another word that's related to it, is suffering, enduring, even to death. All right? So this word suffering, or suffered, or suffer, is throughout this book of 1 Peter, and 1 Peter is helping us to work through our suffering. So my challenge for you this week is to sit down, read 1 Peter, and underline everywhere that is talked about suffering. All right? And suffering is described at least 7 different words in the Greek, which is translated grieved, tested, endured, insulted, waging war, reviled, slandered, spoken against. I knew I was pushing that one off the screen. I knew I was close, but I was hoping it was on there. All right. So I kind of want to give you a little sneak peek about what we're going to be talking about in 1 Peter. So in 1 Peter, chapter 1, verse 6, it says, In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes through the test, it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So in chapter 1, we're going to talk about this idea of rejoicing and this idea of when we are suffering, what we are to do. We are to rejoice that we are in Jesus Christ, even though we might be suffering and persecuted. That is testing our faith. That is in it is building our faith because we have Jesus Christ on our side. And we can rejoice in that. Chapter 2, beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles, keep your conduct honorable so that when they may see your good deeds, for this is the gracious thing. When mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. So chapter 2, we're going to talk about what our actions are when we are in this time either of persecution or suffering. What do our actions look like? And we're going to talk about how to be good characters even though we are suffering. For what credit is it if, when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But when you do good and suffer for it, you endure. This is gracious living in the sight of God. And in chapter 3, but even if you should suffer for righteous sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason of the hope that you have, yet do it with gentleness and respect. So in chapter 3, we're going to talk about this idea of being holy, being set apart from the world because we are followers of Jesus Christ. And when people ask, be ready to explain that to people. And when people ask you, give them an answer. And do it with gentleness and respect because we want to show them the love of Jesus. Amen? Amen. Chapter 4, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange was happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God's name. Again, we're talking about what our character is like in the midst of suffering. And chapter 5, be sober-minded, be watchful, for adversary the devil prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kind of sufferings are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. This kind of echoes the idea of what James is talking about in his book. All right, James is written to the Jewish exiles. Peter is written to the Gentile exiles. So these books are kind of reflective of each other. In James, it says, count it all joy, my brother, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and that steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking nothing. So in this suffering and this persecution, when persecution strikes, know that Jesus Christ is there with us, and he's going to help us through it. And in that persecution, it is going to build our faith. It is going to build our character in Christ Jesus. When persecution strikes, don't be afraid. Jesus has already been victorious. Amen? So this is kind of the application of this of today is, know that don't be afraid. Jesus is already victorious, and he is there. Always remember to acknowledge Jesus as Lord. That should be in the front of our mind, that Jesus is Lord. He is the one that has already had the victory over death, and in our suffering, he is there. Always be ready to explain why you are so hopeful. The hope that we have in Jesus Christ. Be ready to explain that. That Jesus is alive. He is the Son of the living God, and he is our Savior. Always maintain gentleness and respect. You catch more flies with honey, right? That's what I've heard anyway. I've never caught a fly with honey, but that's what I've heard. But maintain gentleness and respect, because that is part of the character of Jesus, right? Yeah, Jesus did get upset, and there were times where he threw the tables over, but in that, he was justified. He was, what's the word? Righteous anger. That's the word. It was righteous anger. All right? Let your behavior shame those who will speak ill about you. All right? Have you ever... that we are following Jesus Christ. No one is exempt from catastrophe, pain, illness, or death. We all face trials, but as Christians, we can rest assured that there is hope and assurance in Christ Jesus for those who trust him. That's my challenge for you this week, is to, number one, read through the book of 1 Peter. Number two, remember, we are Christians. We are followers of Jesus. We are children of the living God. And we need to be able to stand up and act that way, right? Let me pray. Jesus, I thank you. I thank you for this message that you've given us through 1 Peter, Lord. And as we dig into this book, I just pray that we will be able to digest it into our souls, and we will be able to grow more and more like Jesus each and every day. And as we think about this and we read through 1 Peter this week, I just pray that it penetrates our hearts and it becomes internal to us. We love you, we praise you, in Jesus' name, amen. As we come to our time of communion today, we want to just take a moment, and I want to have us all kind of meditate and reflect on Jesus, the love that he has for us, the love that brought him to this earth. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but what? Have eternal life. And as we go to the tables this week, I want us to reflect on that. Reflect on when persecution strikes. Not if, but when suffering strikes in our lives. Jesus is the one that we hold on to. Jesus is the one that we cry out to. So as this next song plays, and as you feel led, we have communion elements on each side of the room here. Go and take a cup, and as you feel led, eat that bread that represents his body that was broken for us on that cross. And take that juice that represents his blood that was shed to cover us and bring us the forgiveness and the ability to have an intimate relationship with God. Let me pray, and during this next song, please make your way to the tables. Jesus, we want to come and we want to thank you for what you did on that cross. We want to thank you for the love that you have for us that is so big that you would come and you would die a sinner's death so that we could come to you, that we can have eternal life because of what you did for us. And we want to thank you for that, Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Thank you.
shut the